نكاح مبارك زواج مبارك النكاح من سنتي ما قال النبي هو الصحيح نكاح مبارك
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome again, brothers and sisters, to another episode in the series titled Marriage and Divorce with our Sheikh Haitham al-Haddad, who currently resides in the UK and is on the board of the Islamic Sharia Council of Britain. He's also the founding member of the website www.islam21c.com. We concluded the last episode by mentioning specific points to do with the walima and how to carry it out in a halal way, shall we say. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Couple of questions before we move on from the walima. I wanted to ask, if a person is fasting, should they attend?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah. This is a good question. This means that the walima is done during the daytime.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, what is the best time to do the walima? Is it the morning, after duhur, after asr, or in the evening? Now, in some customs, they do it in the morning. It seems, from the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the walima was in the morning. Yeah, it seems, okay? But if it is done after duhur or after asr, that's okay. In some other customs, they do it before the rukhsati or before consummating the marriage. At night. Yeah, if it happened that it was done in the daytime and the person was fasting, the scholar said if it was a wajib fasting, yeah, then you attend and make dua. And there is a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned something like this. فَلْيَدْعُ بِخَيْرٍ. Okay? If it was obligatory fasting. Now, some scholars also mentioned some condition that they said if it is an obligatory fasting, but you can break your fast to fast another day.
To make it up.
Mm-hmm. And that day is not obligatory upon you. Upon you is a number, a specific number of days, which can be done either that day or any other day. Yeah? And they said that the person who invited you might feel a bit uneasy. Okay? So they said it is recommended in this case to break your fast to attend the walima. Even some scholars said if you are going to add a value for, if he is going to be really happy that you have attended. Why is this? Because Sharia wants us to love each other.
We want unity and community and society.
Yes.
To be.
And subhanAllah, Sharia gives yani the rights of people in many cases a high status. Yeah, especially what puts love between them, and as you said, unity and community, etc. The scholars also said that if your fast is not obligatory, then it is recommended that you break your fast. Some scholars said you must break your fast.
Can we
because
define
attending walima is wajib, and this fast is not wajib.
So
they said the wajib takes precedent over what? Non-wajib fasting. Some other scholars said the matter is flexible. So if you can take permission from the person, wallahi, akhi, I will be fasting if you allow me. Right? And then he said, okay, no problem. Or he said, wallahi, مثلاً, Daniel, you are an important person of the community, and if you don't attend my walima, people will say, what's wrong? Okay, maybe there is something. Then you must attend. Obviously, when you attend, people are eating, you are going to eat with them. So if there is a real maslaha, real benefit, then you should attend and break your fast if your fast is not obligatory on that day.
This is my next question, just for the audience and for myself. What do we consider an obligatory fast?
Obligatory fast, for example, the person is making up the days
of Ramadan.
Yeah? Or the person took an oath upon himself to fast. That particular day means that particular day becomes wajib on him. Or the person broke an oath. Yeah? فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ. Yeah? So he has to pay the fidya of breaking the oath, which is fasting 3 days, if he can't pay money. Okay? So these are examples of obligatory fasting. Or if a person, for example, if he had sexual relationship, full sexual relationship during the month of Ramadan, and he started to make the fidya, fasting 2 consecutive months. And in between, yeah, he was invited to a walima. Then for him, yeah, he's not excused to break the 2 consecutive months. Yeah.
Sheikh, just before we continue, is there anything else that you would like to add about the walima before we change the topic?
I think these are the most important things regarding the walima. I always just advise sisters in particular that whenever they go to walima, to be careful, yeah? And of course, they want to enjoy their time, etc., but they have to be safe, not to be seen or even pictured. Well, maybe this is another
this is very important issue.
Pictured by men, by non-mahram men, or by women who are going to share their photos with non-mahram men. This is a very common mistake that is happening these days. Yeah, and it is very strange that you will see sisters attending a nikah, yeah, the walima. And then some of them are taking photos of each other on their mobile phones. And they allow it. These are some practicing sisters. They allow this. They say, well, it is in her own mobile phone. But you remember some of the photos that were taken, yeah, for us here in the studio. In one day, okay, because they were put, I don't know how they went to Google Plus or whatever. In one day, we saw them with other people. I received them from other people. This can happen easily.
And very quickly.
And very quickly. So I said to sister, to be careful. We spoke about this and how can this be abused. This is something to be observed carefully. Yeah.
So now that we've concluded the issue of the walima, I mentioned before that I wanted to ask you about the consummation of the marriage.
Yeah.
We slightly jumped ahead, but inshallah, we'll just spend a few moments to talk about the consummation. Is there anything that you think would be valuable to be mentioned about this?
About the consummation of marriage. Well, to be honest with you, there are a few things to be mentioned about the consummation of marriage. Obviously, we can mention general things, okay? Some specific things need to be discussed face to face. Yeah? By the way, once I received a question, in fact, a few times we received questions in the Islamic Sharia Council about developing websites, Islamic websites for sexual or for intimacy for Muslims.
So advice?
Not only advice, they want to put some graphics, pictures of forms of intimacy, etc. Is this allowed or not? We also received a question which was a bit strange that they want to promote or announce or advertise objects that are used in sexual relationship. Yeah, is it allowed or not? This is apart from lingerie. No, we are not talking about that. Talking about, okay, objects that are used in sexual relationship. A brother approached me because he wants to develop a book. And he wants to develop it even further to make it an app to explain a few things about sexual relationship. Is this allowed or not allowed? Or this is very problematic. Very problematic. Now, the brothers in general say, but people need to know about these things. Yeah? How are we going to educate them? Akhi, if we want to educate them, not through pictures they see, because those pictures will be seen by everyone. Is this allowed or not? Okay? So it can be, I always advise the brother or the sister, if they are going to get married and they want to consummate the marriage, if they don't know what they may do, yeah? Because Even some scholars said that the knowledge of how to consummate the marriage is in the fitrah of human beings. Yeah? The fitrah of all living beings, human and even non-human being. Without teaching them,
happens anyway.
It happens and they know. Maybe some people, for whatever reason, they might not be aware. Then those individuals, we cannot develop websites for them just for 2, 3, or 5 or whatever. We cannot draw pictures or take pictures just to educate these people. If there are people like this, they can approach some of their relatives. Yeah? If they are embarrassed, yani the sister is embarrassed to speak to her mother or to speak, definitely she will be embarrassed to speak to her father, or the father is embarrassed to speak to his son. Yeah? Maybe me as a father, I can ask another friend of mine to speak to my son. Yeah? To speak to my daughter. The mother can appoint someone to speak to her daughter if she is embarrassed to speak about some internal issues related to intimacy. Let us not make it open public discussion, do this, don't do this. In fatwas, yes. But those fatwas should be asked one-to-one.
They're specific.
Specific. Nowadays, there are some important questions not related to sexual intimacy that we normally ask the person to call us directly to speak to him or to her. Yeah? So let alone about sexual intimacy. Yeah? About intimacy in general or sexual relationship. Okay?
Brothers and sisters, please return to us in a couple of minutes where we shall continue this discussion. At the moment, specifically on the consummation of marriage. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. An-nikahu min sunnati.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth, and who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik every Sunday to Friday at 9 p.m. and repeat telecast at 7:30 a.m. India on Peace TV. Peace TV presents over 100 million viewers at one of the largest peace conferences in the world, addressing a sea of spellbound spectators, over 30 world-renowned orators on Islam, with credentials impeccable.
The truth of Islam.
Deen is your way of life.
It is our duty, our obligation.
By following the Quran and Sunnah,
we will give the message to one and all.
With articulation exquisite.
Read the book of Allah.
Islam is the easy way. It's the simple way.
Remind each other.
The Muslim is not a source of harm for other people.
Collaborate with the people for good.
This is the call of Islam.
With the mission of spreading the truth of Islam.
Do what you can to spread the word of Islam.
Wherever we are,
live like Muslims.
Use your power.
Allah is saying, why do you need anything else? This Quran is self-sufficient.
The only book on the face of the globe, the Quran.
How a human being should lead his life is given in this instruction manual, the glorious Quran.
For peace to prevail on earth in peacemakers. Next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome again, brothers and sisters, to this discussion with myself and our Sheikh Haitham Al-Haddad on the discussion of the consummation of marriage. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Before we move on to another topic, we wanted to finalize this, the consummation of marriage. You were mentioning how to do this, whether it's a taboo or whether it's not a taboo, or whether it should be widespread.
Yes. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. I was saying that the fitrah of all living beings, human and even non-human being, without teaching them,
happens anyway.
It happens and they know. Maybe some people, for whatever reason, they might not be aware. Then those individuals, we cannot develop websites for them just for 2, 3, or 5 or whatever. We cannot draw pictures or take pictures just to educate these people. If there are people like this, they can approach some of their relatives, yeah? If they are embarrassed, yani the sister is embarrassed to speak to her mother or to speak, definitely she will be embarrassed to speak to her father, or the father is embarrassed to speak to his son, yeah? Maybe me as a father, I can ask another friend of mine to speak to my son, yeah, to speak to my daughter. The mother can appoint someone to speak to her daughter if she's embarrassed to speak about some internal issues related to intimacy. Let us not make it open public discussion, do this, don't do this. In fatwas, yes, but those fatwas should be asked one-to-one.
They're specific.
Specific. Nowadays, there are some important questions not related to sexual intimacy that we normally ask the person to call us directly to speak to him or to her, yeah? So let alone about sexual intimacy. It should not be an open and public discussion with details. But the issue in general that during the marriage there will be consummation of marriage, etc., it should be mentioned. It should not be made as if it was a taboo. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And also, from the other angle, it should not be discussed in details. Because there is a level of decency, and we don't want to promote certain acts in public. Yeah? So this is the general guideline. If, as I said, if there is a person who doesn't know what may happen or how to do certain things, he should approach a person of trust. Yeah? And if this person of trust is a person of knowledge, that would be even better. To discuss the matter privately with him or with her. A sister can discuss the matter with one of her teachers or with her mother or with her elder sister or with her auntie, something like this. Or the auntie sometimes, yeah, may approach their niece to discuss the matter. Are you ready? Do you want anything? Yes. And they should make it also as a happy occasion, mm-hmm. not as you might, something strange might happen to you to create this level of fear. Okay? No. It should be made as something of happy and enjoyment. Maybe in some cultures, it might be good for the parents and in particular the mother to say to her daughter that, okay, now you are getting married to this person, he is your husband. So, he is your husband, he is halal for you, you are halal for him. So if he touches you, even if you undressed in front of him, this is halal, it is ibadah, don't worry about it, because some women from certain cultures are very shy, especially innocent girls, especially virgin girls, and they have not been exposed to something like this before. Yeah? So they might have some level of reservation. And we have heard of stories where the girls, because of fear, they develop kind of phobia, and they are unable to consummate the marriage. Same thing with the men as well. Okay? Also, the scholar said that it is recommended that the man approaches the wife when the wedding is there, yeah? Either the consummation of marriage happened in their house, in the hotel, in any place, okay? And then they move to another place. All these are matters related to custom, yeah? It depends on that custom. In some customs, the man is brought to the wife. And they say that it is the sunnah, maybe, because, you know, in the hadith of Aisha, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was young. When she reached the age of puberty, the Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, her father, said to the Prophet sallam that your wife is ready now to consummate the marriage. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, my mother took me, I was playing even with my friends, took me and took me to some women from Ansar, and they prepared me in terms of dress, in terms of cleaning, in terms of maybe makeup, okay? Something like this can happen. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam entered upon me. And one of the women from Al-Ansar, yeah, was there. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to Aisha, and he had some sweet or some drink which is sweet. So he offered it to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. The scholar said that it is good for the man, yeah, to break the ice, yeah, and to soften the heart of his wife, because especially if she is virgin and so on, yeah, to do something like this, mulatafa, to be soft, to be gentle, to speak few words, something like this, in order to break the ice. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was shy, and she did not take it directly from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That woman told her, take, this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, take from him. So she took and she had something from that, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had something from this. The scholars also mentioned that it is sunnah to pray two rak'ah with her. Now, did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam do this, to pray two rak'ah with his wife, yeah, during the wedding day or before the consummation of marriage? It was not reported that the Prophet ﷺ did it, but it was reported that two, one maybe from the companions and one from the second generation, did something like this. And even in the case of the companion, he was asked. A man came to one of the companions or one of the scholars from the second generation, and he said to him that I'm going to get married and I'm afraid that my wife might maybe dislike me for whatever reason, or might repel, or so the companion told him, love is from Allah and hate is from shaitan, but it is the qadar of Allah, definitely. So he said, if you go and you want to consummate the marriage, so pray two rak'ah with her, lead the salah. Obviously the person is not going to read Surah Baqarah in Surah, yeah, and these two rak'ah, and is not going to do Qiyam al-Layl. Now, this is just two rak'ah. Some scholars, based on this, said that it is recommended, or maybe some of them said it is mustahab or sunnah. It is not confirmed that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did them. Then after that, the person might approach his wife. After that or before that, it is not a big issue. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا تَزَوَّجَ أَحَدُكُمْ إِمْرَأَ فَلِيَأْخُذْ بِنَاصِيَتِهَا. When a person marries, he should put his hand on the forehead of his wife, and he should say the very famous dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka min khayriha wa khayri ma jubilat alayhi wa a'udhu bika min sharri wa sharri ma jubilat alayhi. Oh Allah, I ask you from her khayr, and the khayr on she was created, or the khayr that she was created from. Yeah? And a'udhu bika min sharri wa sharri ma jubilat alayhi. This hadith can be said in English. You can find it in any book of dua, the fortress of the Muslim also. And then maybe the person, if he wants to do the foreplay and start maybe the full sexual relationship, before starting the full sexual relationship or before starting the foreplay, two possibilities, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recommended us to recite another dua. Yes? بسم الله اللهم جنبني الشيطان وجنب الشيطان ما رزقتني. Oh Allah, save me from the shaitan and save the whatever you give me on this night from the shaitan. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if you say this, then it is that the shaitan will not harm what Allah جل وعلا has provided you on that night. This is the summary of what can be done and how it can be done during the night of wedding or the night or the day of consummation of marriage.
This is the end of the episode now. Do you think we need another episode to continue the discussion, or do you think this is enough for the consummation of the marriage?
No, inshallah, this will be enough for consummation of the marriage.
Brothers and sisters, please come back to us in the next episode where we shall move on from this topic and go to the topic of the rights of the husband over the wife. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.